This video discusses a range of issues and events that might result in distress for some individuals. Discussions in this video might also provoke strong emotional responses. To make sure that everyone collectively benefits from this video and do not feel disturbed due to the content, we would like to state that we will be discussing rape and sexual assault in necessary detail.
Conversely, this does not mean that you need to feel restrained about what you feel and what you want to say. This is about creating a safe space where everyone can talk without fear or inhibitions. This responsibility not only lies with us, but also with all of you. And we hope that with your engagement with this topic, you will be respectful and empathetic.
In our last video, we showed you how rape laws have evolved to what they are today. In this video, we'll talk about rape laws. We will be breaking down the current laws on rape, its shortcomings, and the common stereotypes in the film industry. And we'll also be seeing how deeply ingrained rape culture is, even within our judges.
There is a very prevalent rape culture in India. We see numerous instances of rape in rural parts of the country. However, none of them have led to the kind of outrage the Nirbhaya case brought about. Nirbhaya was an urban-dwelling, educated woman who was coming back from a movie. This setting resonated with a lot of the middle-class population in India. Because this instance happened in an urban public space, the middle class finally came to the streets and demanded change.
So we asked Preeta Jha, a practicing advocate and an academic, on what she thought of all this.
You know, in many of the cases throughout the history of Indian jurisprudence, we've seen that the court has been infamous for treating people from different socioeconomic classes differently and even unfairly. So we were wondering if you could comment on what are the systematic barriers and what can we do to necessarily address this?
Right. So I think, you know, if let's talk about caste, for example, right, or class. You see, these are, you know, it's impossible unless, again, you know, your judicial training has given you that insight that, you know, it's that understanding of equality, if that has really gone through, because that doesn't, you don't get that with a law degree. Practicing equality and getting that framework that, you know, just because I'm a man or just because I'm a higher caste man or whatever, just because I have a job which pays me X amount, it doesn't mean that I am better than everybody else, right? So, you know, the question you're asking is, you know, the law certainly doesn't say that they should, you know, it's not the law which is at fault, right? The written law. Written law is not saying that you treat lower caste and lower class people differently. So that's what you're talking about, lived law, right? How do you change that? So, you know, big question, tell me.
Before the Criminal Law Amendment Act 2013, rape was defined as just intercourse between a man and a woman. That is, if a penis is inserted into a vagina non-consensually. But the law today is a lot more expansive, and thank feminists for that.
Section 375 of the Indian Penal Code defines rape as any penetration by a penis, an object, or any body part into a vagina, a mouth, urethra, or anus of a woman.
Any manipulation of a woman's body to allow penetration or oral sex given to or received from a woman is criminalized as well. It is important to note that this section applies only to a perpetrator who is a man and a victim who is a woman. It is also important to note that if a man makes the woman perform any of the acts with another man or makes the woman perform such acts on him, it is considered as rape.
The section describes seven situations in which the consent of the victim is either taken using by unfair means or force or is not taken at all. Let us understand these seven situations in detail right now. So, Trina, what if a girl is at a party and a man makes unwelcome sexual advances towards her? She refuses him and asks him to leave, but despite her will, he forces himself upon her.
It's rape, right? It's definitely rape.
Yeah, so this would amount to the first situation under the section. This act would amount to rape against her will.
Ramya, what do you think if two people are in a romantic relationship and if the man asks the woman if he wants to have sex and, you know, she says, no, I have a headache and I don't want to have sex, but the man ignores it and still has sex with her anyway. What about this?
Yeah, bro, this would definitely amount to rape without her consent.
Correct.
I award Gryffindor House 60 points.
Okay, we're getting a little graphic now. What if a brother and sister were held at a gunpoint? The gunman threatens a sister with hurting her brother if she refuses his sexual advances. Fearing for her and her brother's life, she gives in.
This unquestionably has to be rape. I mean, I understand that it's with her consent, but it's being obtained by putting her or any other person in whom she is interested in fear of death or of hurt. Let's try another scenario. Do you remember the movie Main Prem Ki Deewani Hoon? So Kareena Kapoor and her entire family believe that Hrithik Roshan will be their future son-in-law. But he is impersonating Abhishek Bachchan, who is a real setup for Kareena to marry. In such a situation, if Hrithik had engaged in a sexual activity with Kareena, knowing fully well that she expects him to marry her and be her husband, but he had no intentions to marry her, do you think this is still rape?
This sounds ridiculous. But weirdly enough, such a scenario is rape with her consent, where the woman believes that the man she consented to is or will be her future husband. Okay, let's look at another scenario. Say if a girl is so drunk, either by her own choice or under undue pressure by another man, that she can barely stand up or form coherent sentences and is not in a position to make a rational choice. If a man then takes advantage of a woman and forces himself on her, would this be rape?
Definitely. In this case, the consent was given at a time when the woman was intoxicated or of unsound mind, which made her unable to understand what she was even consenting to.
So the next scenario is where someone tries to have sex with someone below the age of 18. Since the age of consent in India is 18, this would amount to rape.
This, however, is very contentious. 18 being the age of consent ignores consensual teen relationships. We see cases where teenage boys are being charged for rape by the girl's parents, even if they were consensually together.
So because of this, there has been an ongoing debate on whether the age of consent should be 18 or 16.
So that is, you know, a huge problem, the adolescent sexuality issue. Recently, there were two children and they had run away and they were both charged. Sometimes even if the girl is like 17 and the boy is 14, they will still charge the boy. And even our understanding, I remember a case in which the boy was 17 and the girl was 19. And people who were consulting me were saying, you know, what can we do to him? I was like, don't go to the police. She can, on the law, be charged with POXO. She's older. She's an adult. But, you know, that male-female thing is the men who are the perpetrators or the aggressors. It's so sort of inscribed in our brains. And you know, we have to hold them responsible. Agency, you know, women don't decide to have sex. Women can't decide. Women don't make those decisions. And that's a really big problem. That's, you know, so that's leading to imprisonment of women in shelters, cases against the people they love. So, you know, the defining principles of POXO are that it should be in the best interest of the child. And I question, how is it in the best interest of the child that the person that she believes she loves or wants to get married to is being incarcerated, is going to jail, is going to get convicted? So that's one side of it. It's, of course, as usual in India, very complex, not always so simple, because, you know, a lot of cases where this has happened, I've heard girls saying, he was saying, ki wo apne aap ko mar lega, he'll commit suicide, so I thought I had to run away with him. So it's not so black and white. And when you're under 18, are you in the best place to make these decisions of running away or not running away? You know, it's a lot of, but the main thing is that it should be just dealt with as two immature people running away together. Let it be, you know, tell them, as I say, that, you know, you can do whatever when you're 18, but as per the law, you can't do this now. But, you know.
What do you guys feel about this? Do you think 18 is fine or 16 is too young? Do let us know in the comments down below.
The last scenario is if anyone tries to have sex with someone who is disabled in a way that they're unable to communicate their consent, it would amount to rape.
Unlike Kalki Cochin in Margarita with a Straw, in which case she could and she wanted to consent.
Remember when Amitabh Bachchan said no is no?
No. No, Your Honor. Na sirf ek shabd nahi, apne aap mein ek pura vakya hai, Your Honor. Ise kisi tark, स्पष्टीकरण एक्सप्लेनेशन या व्याख्या की जरूरत नहीं होती। ना का मतलब ना ही होता है। My client said no, Your Honor. And these boys must realize no ka matlab no hota.
I almost believed him. Because this is where the Delhi High Court in the case of Mehmood Farooqi versus State of Delhi disagrees. So let's talk about it. This was an interesting case involving the law and Bollywood and ended up dividing feminists across the country. Unfortunately for us, this remains the standard as of today, at least in the state of Delhi.
The complainant in the Farooqi case was an American PhD student who alleged rape against Farooqi, the director of Peepli Live. The incident took place at his house, and when she arrived, the accused was already intoxicated and his wife was not at home. He forcibly kissed and performed oral sex on her. Both acts she said no to. Out of fear, she stopped resisting and faked an orgasm to put an end to it. The trial court convicted Mohammad Farooqi under Section 375 for non-consensually performing oral sex on her. The High Court, however, ignored the law and used harmful stereotypes and unfounded prejudices to overturn this decision.
In our jurisprudence, there is a category of witnesses called sterling witnesses. What this means is that if a witness is able to provide clear testimony that does not have any contradictions, fits the timeline of events, and is consistent, they will be called a sterling witness. So when a court is hearing such a witness, they should accept their testimony at face value without any hesitation. In this case, the trial court said that the prosecutrix was a sterling witness. The Delhi High Court agreed as well. Yet, it chose to disbelieve her and held the exact opposite.
What? Doesn't it make the entire thing pointless then?
Yes, exactly. Concepts like the sterling witness have been introduced to encourage more victims to come out against rape. Most cases of rape do not have witnesses. There is not much evidence either.
Yeah, I mean, that makes sense because most rape happens in private.
Yeah, it's not like a murder where there is blood everywhere, there's a dead body, and there is a weapon with DNA on it. So a lot of times, the only evidence that is available is the victim's testimony. So having such a thing such as a sterling witness eases the high burden placed upon them.
So when the Delhi High Court on one hand said that the prosecutrix was a sterling witness, but on the other hand said that we won't believe you, it shows that the court is still reluctant to believe the victim, especially when it does not even provide any reasons to disbelieve her.
What this judgment is most criticized for is for its warped idea of consent. In Section 375, it is made very clear that a woman must consent explicitly. It can be by words, gestures, or any form of verbal or non-verbal act. As long as it shows that she is willing to participate, it would mean consent.
The court had the audacity to go against not only the law, but also Amitabh Bachchan, and said that a feeble no isn't a no. What's more troubling is the fact that nowhere during the trial was it suggested by either of the parties that the complainant's refusal was feeble. It was made clear by her that she refused his advances not only by saying no, but also by pulling up her clothes and by physically resisting him on the divan. This the court just plain ignored and without any reasoning assumed that her refusal was feeble and was not enough.
What more did the court want then?
The court went wrong in more than one way. It first said that even if someone says no, it can still be consent if the man did not understand her no to mean no. The court put an additional responsibility on women to make sure that the man understands her willingness. This completely takes away the responsibility on a man to actually ask for consent. This is one of the many ways in which the woman is completely absent from her own rape trial.
The complainant and the perpetrator had a past sexual history. In a disappointing move, the court placed meaning in this to excuse the current act of rape. Section 146 of the Indian Evidence Act does not permit courts to consider past sexual history when considering the present allegation. But this court, adamant on its senseless logic, said that the quality of consent differs when the two parties have a shared sexual history. And hence, coming to the conclusion that her no might have been a feeble no, as she was okay with such acts in the past. It also assumed that academic or well-educated people will be in a better position to make their unwillingness known. This does not follow either logic or common sense.
Yeah, as we said, senseless, fuck all, and completely illogical.
Now let's look at section 376 of the IPC that provides for punishment in the cases of rape. Anyone who commits rape can be sent to jail ranging from 10 to 30 years. But if you fall under any of the following categories below, the punishment can extend from 10 years until they die.
People like police officers, public servants, members of armed forces, management of a jail, hospital or remand home, or even children's institutions.
Relatives, guardians or teachers, rape committed during acts of communal violence such as the Gujarat riots, if the woman is known to be pregnant and is still raped, if she's under the age of 18, or if she's incapable of giving her consent.
And lastly, anyone who is in a position of control or dominance over a woman commits rape, or also on a woman who is mentally or physically disabled, will be punished.
For lawmakers on Friday acquitted former union minister and BJP leader Swami Chinmayanand of keeping a law student in captivity at Shahjahanpur allegedly to rape her. The prosecution could not prove its case beyond a reasonable doubt is what the judge said, acquitting him of the charges. The court ordered acquittal as all witnesses in the case had turned hostile.
Before we address this, let's take a look at Section 376C.
Section 376C of the Indian Penal Code goes one step further to provide strict liability for sexual intercourse by a person in a position of authority.
So, what is strict liability?
It is when the law assumes that rape has taken place owing purely to the circumstance. This means that if a person is in authority, engages in sexual activity with anyone under their care, the law will punish them. This allows for a lower burden of proof on the complainant. Any such abuse of power will result in a sentencing of 5 years, which may extend up to 10 years.
Who are these people who can be held responsible for abusing their authority? Well, it ranges from a public servant,
a superintendent,
a manager of a jail,
or remand home, or any other place of custody.
Or lastly, anyone who is part of the management staff of a hospital.
Let's take an example to understand this better. If a superintendent in a jail has sexual intercourse with a girl inmate, the officer will be guilty of this offence. It does not matter whether or not she gave her consent.
This is because this section sees that a girl in a jail cell does not have much choice in the situation. She is at the mercy of the person in authority who is responsible for her care. Because of this imbalance of power, her consent can never be a free will.
This is why this section does not even allow the perpetrator to claim that consent existed. It will assume guilt on the part of the superintendent the second it is proved that the sexual activity did occur.
A controversial real-life case in which this section was used and caused quite the stir was a case of a BJP leader and former union minister Swami Chinmayanand. He was accused of rape and sexual harassment by a law student in Shahjahanpur. The police in this case did not charge him for rape, but rather filed a case under sexual intercourse by a person in authority.
Since he is in a position of authority, the police was not entirely wrong. But by failing to charge him under Section 375 for aggravated rape, they helped him avoid a stricter punishment. Here's how. Firstly, Section 376C carries a lesser term of punishment as compared to Section 375 of the IPC. When we say less, we mean really less, like criminally less. Rape punishes the perpetrator for a minimum of 10 years, extending to life. But sexual intercourse punishes for a minimum of 5 years, extending up to 10. So the maximum sentence Chinmayanand would get is the minimum he would have received if he had been tried for rape.
This section can be interpreted to mean that the complainant gave her consent but was induced or seduced to do so. This is so wrong on so many levels. By saying that she was induced or seduced, it pretends like she had some choice or say and on some level was willing to do it. This section purposefully does not call it rape but rather calls it sexual intercourse. Why? We really don't know. So if any of you find out, do let us know.
Swami Chinmayanand is not new to such allegations, and given his political influence, he has always managed to get himself out of these situations.
Issues of day-to-day criminal justice, cultural realities of our court system, that's what needs to change. You need to have lack of corruption, one thing we haven't talked about. Yeah. In any case, political power, influence, bribing, fear,
yeah,
leading to witnesses not willing to give evidence, yeah, proper investigation, yeah, forensic evidence, all kinds of evidence that the police can, and you know, training and stuff in that is required. I think the problems are there. I don't think the problems are in trying to get a new law.
Using his power, he was able to make the complainant accept a lesser punishment for him out of fear. The fact that his lawyer, the police, and even the special investigation team were able to conveniently apply an offense with lesser gravity shows how it is possible to just section Shaw.
This section, which is a major win for women at the same time, can also be exploited by those in a position of power at their convenience. It is a perfect example where the law's limitations are exposed. There is only so much that the law can do. At the end of the day, it's just a set of written rules and cannot substitute larger cultural, social, political, and economic reform. This is why we should remember that the law is only one of the means to justice.
उसे बोलने वाली लड़की कोई परिचित हो, friend हो, girlfriend हो, कोई sex worker हो, या आपकी अपनी बीवी क्यों? No means no.
Ambitious, but wrong, because marital rape is still not a crime in India. Marital rape is an exception to rape in India. Despite consistent efforts to change it, it is still legal today. Why?
One reason is because many believe that there is implied consent in a marriage. Apparently, when a woman gets married, she gives her consent in perpetuity to the man, and it cannot be otherwise.
Another reason was that criminalizing marital rape meant that the state can now interfere in very private and personal affairs as well. This is something people are not willing to allow.
However, the law is not completely silent on marital rape. The Protection of Women from Domestic Violence Act criminalizes sexual conduct that abuses, humiliates, degrades, or violates a woman's dignity. Marital rape covered through this law hesitates to call it rape. This shows a denial by society and the law of rape even happening in marriages, the sexual agency of a woman, and how she is the object of her husband's desires.
Basically, what we mean to say is that this shit is fuck all, and Section 375 exception 2 makes no sense and needs to go.
Our dear lawyer friend forgot to mention men, trans folk, and other sexual minorities. Amitabh Bachchan might have forgotten about that, but our man, Justice J.S. Verma, surely did it.
Gender-specific rape laws exclude men and trans folk from bringing forth allegations about sexual crimes committed onto them. Gender neutrality of rape laws has been a recurring suggestion for a while, and yet it has never been changed. It seems only fair that if recent statistics have been showing increased sexual crimes being committed against these excluded categories, why is it that the law does not reflect these categories and does not extend its provision toward them? This topic has been widely debated for a very long time, and still not everyone agrees over what needs to be done.
You mentioned the fact that like people are not ready to accept the inverse dynamics of a woman perpetrating a sexual crime towards man. And after the 83 amendment, neutrality of the law was actually suggested, and the court had even agreed to it, but feminist groups had filed an intervention saying the way patriarchy works is that only women can be victims of such crimes. And now the IPC still defines rape as something that's committed by a man or a woman. So why do you think that we haven't reached this point of understanding?
We have. POCSO is gender neutral. Women can be perpetrators or victims, right? So for child sexual abuse, it is. But yeah, you're right. For and to a certain extent, that applies to domestic violence and rape law. And I tend to agree with that, not because men can't, women can't rape men, or women can't carry out domestic violence. But we have a society in which the power structure is so towards men, right? Same with sexual harassment at workplace. You know, our law says that it's only men who can do it to women. It doesn't say that in US. And there's a reason for that, because in US you have women who are in positions of power, at least not 50-50, but you can say 30%. In India, only 30% of women are in formal workforce. Very, very small percentage of women are in positions of power. And the problem with doing that, if you made it gender neutral, is in every case of domestic violence, lawyers would say to men, tumhare saath bhi domestic violence hua hai. The whole thing would get much longer with complaints and cross complaints and affidavits and cross affidavits. I think it's a pragmatic and practical thing. To have the law as it is, given the social reality of India, I don't think there's a problem with that.
Yeah, And I guess that kind of makes sense, right? In a bold move, the Criminal Law Amendment Bill 2012 proposed gender-neutral laws for the Parliament to consider. However, this was never passed. It was recommended to expand the definition of victims under Section 375 on rape. Complainants would now include men, trans folk, and other sexual minorities along with women, while the perpetrator continued to remain a man.
Kind of makes sense, doesn't it? It takes Preeta ma'am's concerns into account, and it also allows victims of all gender and sexes to complain against injustice.
Yeah, it does, no? But many people didn't agree. Civil organizations, lawyers, academics like Jagodi, Lawyers Collective, Nirantar, Women Against Sexual Violence, State Repression Forum Against Oppression of Women, and Madhya Pradesh Mahila Manch opposed these changes.
What? I thought this makes sense. Like, because it's not like men or trans folk don't get raped. I don't see why this is a problem.
Well, they argued that sexual crimes can only happen to women due to patriarchy.
But doesn't patriarchy also affect men, trans folk, and other sexual minorities as well?
Yes, precisely. And this is why it is very necessary to remember that rape is an act of power. And while women do lack substantial power in the Indian context, there are also other things like caste, class, and sexual orientation that affect power dynamics.
So are you saying that an upper caste and class woman might be in a better position of power over a lower caste and class men?
Yes, maybe. Identity politics is not so simple. All I'm saying is that power and privilege cannot be so black and white. We need to consider various intersections like the kind of education you receive, where we live, and our cultural context, the positions of power we occupy, along with other factors such as your caste, class, and gender.
That sounds valid. I think it's wrong to think that feminist politics are only for women. We need to empower anyone who suffers under the system. Do you remember that movie Aitraaz, where Priyanka Chopra abuses her position as the CEO of the company to sexually harass Akshay Kumar?
Yeah, this is why our law does not discriminate between a man or a woman when it comes to sexual offences being committed by anyone who is in a position of authority. Remember 376C? But if Priyanka Chopra wasn't his boss and still had harassed him, he would have nowhere to go to seek justice under the current law.
That's right. Oh my god, this is all so fuckable. The law, however, does try to acknowledge some of these social realities. Like, for example, the Protection of Children from Sexual Offences Act protects all children under the age of 18 from sexual abuse. The Prevention of Atrocities Act prohibits caste-based crimes.
And slowly things are changing. And of course, there are, you know, caste activists who are also fighting in court. Again, the law, I mean, it's only over the last year or two that I've got to know the atrocity law. And I tell you, it's the most victim-centric law that I know of in the whole world. It's the only law where victims have the right to argue for themselves in court in a criminal case. It's a right. It's like in other cases, you have to get the agreement of the judge to put an argument. But despite that, we recently had a case in which we were trying to support, it's actually an atrocity murder case. And had to convince everyone, if you look at Section 15A of the Atrocity Act, it's victims' rights, the new act, the 2015 act. And it gives a number of rights to victims, including, you know, what should happen as part of the criminal procedure, that they should get a copy of the charge sheet. But having that there and practicing it and getting it is something very different, right? And it's often very different because the culture has set in. So as in this case, everybody said, no, we can't do that. I can't argue for the victim. I said, no, read Section 15A. It says you can. In the end, we had to get a lawyer from outside because sometimes when you practice in a certain court, you don't want to quote, say something or do something that's going to affect how you're seen by your colleagues and the judge. So somebody from outside went and argued for an hour and a half, and he said that everybody in the court was like listening and saying, we didn't know that you could say, you could argue for the victim. And it's clearly there in the law in black and white, but it's not happening.
And the latest transgender bill loosely talks about sexual abuse against trans folks. Right now, there is a petition in court to include sexual crimes against trans folk in the IPC, and the court has acknowledged that it is a good petition and requires a hearing. I'll let you know of an update as soon as I have any. We also have a watered-down provision under Section 377 of the IPC that can protect men from being raped by other men. But this act still criminalizes voluntary sexual acts, so we still need a better sodomy law.
Exactly how we need a better gay movie than Dostana, apart from Dostana 2.
Before we shut up, Philip, we just want to say that this brings us to the end of our second video, of our first video, of our trilogy of four on the series called What We Can Learn from Pink. Make sure to check out part 1 and part 3 if you haven't already. The links will be in the description below.
We hope this was a little informative, a little entertaining, and an overall blessing in your life. Do like, share, and subscribe. And if you know anyone from Netflix, do put in a good word for us. See you soon. Bye. Bye. We're done.
Yeah.
Oh my gosh. I'm so worried.